Good afternoon and welcome to the Rumi Forum. We're very happy to have with us today Slovenian Ambassador, Mr. Roman Kirn. He is the Ambassador of Slovenia and he will speak today on Slovenia and diversity management, lessons for the future. Ambassador Kirn began his professional and diplomatic career at the Federal Ministry of Foreign Affairs of SFR Yugoslavia in 1977. He also served at the Committee on Foreign Relations of Slovenia, help me with this name, sir, in
Ljubljana.
Ljubljana.
Ljubljana, that's the capital Ljubljana. Of Slovenia.
Yes, exactly, but it's not a name I'm familiar with speaking. From 1978 to 1980, he rejoined the Federal Ministry of Foreign Affairs in 1980 and served as First Secretary at the Embassy of SFR Yugoslavia in Rangoon and Burma. He returned to Slovenia in 1984, where he worked at the Committee on Foreign Affairs of Slovenia until 1990, in charge of regional cooperation. After Slovenia gained its independence in 1991, he was appointed Director of Multilateral Relations Department in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of the Republic of Slovenia. From 1992 to 1996, he served as Minister Consular at the Embassy of Slovenia in the Prague, Czech Republic. Mr. Kirn was appointed State Undersecretary in the Foreign Ministry in 1996, in charge of multilateral affairs. In this period, he was engaged primarily with the UN and NATO-related issues. He was a member to a number of the Slovenian delegations at the UN General Assembly sessions. He was the head of delegation to the Ottawa process that negotiated the Convention on Prohibition of the Anti-Personnel Landmines, and he was a co-founder of a joint Slovenian-U.S. project, International Trust Fund for Demining and Mine Victims Assistance, ITF, in Southeast Europe, and served as its first chairman of the managing board. He was also in charge for the candidacy of Slovenia to gain its first UN Security Council non-permanent seat in 1997. In August 1996, he joined a week-long VIP program for NATO candidates in Norfolk at the invitation of the U.S. State Department. Prior to his appointment as ambassador and permanent representative of Slovenia to the United Nations in New York, in July 2002, Mr. Kirn served 2 years, 2000 to 2002, as ambassador and permanent representative of Slovenia to the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe, OSCE, Vienna. He served as ambassador to the UN until December 2006. During his tenure, he held different positions and responsibilities, such as vice chairman of the UNICEF Executive Board, vice president of the UN General Assembly, vice president of the 2005 NPT Review Conference, facilitator for revitalization of UN General Assembly, facilitator for UN reform. In January 2007, he joined the Ministry of Foreign Affairs when he was appointed the Director of Department for North and Latin America and the Caribbean. During the Slovenian EU presidency, he was in charge of transatlantic relations and preparations of the EU-US summit held in Slovenia in June 2008. Mr. Kirn holds a BA in International Relations from the University of Ljubljana, and forgive me for speaking it improperly, and speaks English, French, Czech, and Serbian and Croatian. Mr. Kirn was born in Slovenia on December 23, 1952. He is married to Hovana Kirn and has two children. Please welcome Ambassador Kirn.
Thank you.
Yes. Thank you for joining us.
Well, thank you for inviting me. It's I have learned that Rumi Forum is indeed a forum where people of different faith religions meet and openly discusses issues that are so often dividing us, but should get us closer. So I appreciate this invitation and this opportunity to address on the issue that somebody may question what Slovenia could add to that discussion. So as a way of introduction, I would like to maybe offer some clarification on two issues. What Slovenia as a small country can add to this debate of diversity management? And secondly, what do I understand by diversity management? Because in past days I was asked by some of colleagues and friends, what do you mean by that? What do you want to discuss by that? So I guess it's appropriate maybe to share with you what I do understand by diversity management. Because when you say diversity, it's a very common word, and also, you know, just even today I heard a lot of that when we discussed at some forum this morning about Eastern Europe, Central Europe, and the Western Balkans. You cannot discuss these issues but avoiding the word diversity. It's a lot of diversity there. But what is that Slovenia could contribute to that? I would like to highlight maybe two approaches. I would approach more from the external point of diversity than internal, because Slovenia is more or less, let's say, ethnically homogeneous country, also in terms of religion. That does not mean that we do not deal with diversity, that we don't have developed instruments to deal with that, but when you compare with other countries, Slovenia could better serve as a case or case study for external diversity. That means, of course, that as a nation you have to find a way of cohabitation with another cultures, with another nations, in another framework. And when we say diversity management, my point is that differences, that diversity is imminent to every human being, to every society, to every nation, and any community that we live in. So this diversity can both be a source of richness and creativity, but also a great challenge for coexistence. These are two poles that are sometimes very conflicting. And what we need as a member of societies, what we need to do is simply to recognize the political and social dimensions of these differences, and to recognize a need to develop instruments and institutions that effectively address and deal with these differences. So diversity management, therefore, for me, is a concept and strategy how to manage these differences between cultures, states, countries, in terms of history, geography, culture, religion, economy, politics. They are many. And therefore, this concept embraces also interfaith and intercultural dialogue that I wish to address a bit later on. Now, on Slovenian experience, if we go then into the substance with this understanding, for centuries, Slovenia and Slovenians lived in different multinational states. We have only 19 years of our independence, but roughly in 100 years we have changed 6 flags, 6 passports. We have lived in Habsburg monarchy, Austro-Hungarian Empire, Kingdom of Yugoslavia, and lately Socialist Federative Republic of Yugoslavia. All multinational communities within which we, as a small nation now of 2 million, had to find a way to survive. But of course that did not depend only on us, but also on that broader environment. That's why I wish to emphasize that for us this external diversity management is of extreme importance. And our experience from the latest community, the latest association that we lived in Federal Socialist Yugoslavia, could be very instructive nowadays for small nations in international community. Relations among nations in Yugoslav Federation were governed and controlled by Communist Party and by Communist ideology. Why I'm emphasizing that? because that means that this system did not develop the instruments of flexibility. The system was not able to adapt to differences, to the changes that we are always witnessing. In an environment in Yugoslavia, which was really an example of differences. Six republics and two provinces, five nations, three languages, three cultures, mm-hmm. two alphabets. Mm-hmm. So you can imagine now what a scope of diversity. Yet in this environment, in this Yugoslavia, there was no diversity management, but only control of diversity, which is a huge difference. And when time for change came in 1990, this call for democracy was not heard in Yugoslavia. On the contrary, this window of opportunity for democracy was misused for to politically reshape and institutionally rearrange Yugoslavia. In dealing with these apparent differences, nationalism instead, democracy has prevailed. So in fact, Yugoslavia has disintegrated because its constituent nations, especially smaller ones, were deprived of equal participation in power sharing in a federative states. An effort of the biggest nation in that community to dominate brought that Yugoslavia to an end. So you can imagine in such a community with such a scope of diversity, when equality is not a virtue and value, then of course the process of integration may be very, very close. So with that experience lately, but of course, it would take me too long to go into each stage of the community that we live in. But basically, that's for small nations, it's always a challenge how you can live in such a community. And maybe that's a reason why these empires, these multinational communities, has disappeared from the scene of the history. But if we reach that point, then comes logically a question, then why immediately you have opted to join European Union, again another supranational institution? It's a good question, and I would try to offer you an answer. First, because European Union is a community of democratic states. And in fact, European Union, by what it stands for, is a guarantor for preserving high democratic standards in our own state. But at the same time, this European Union, that will be for the foreseeable future, is also a union of national states. That's why for us, for Slovenia, in European Union, the main question is how to ensure equality and the proper balance between the citizenship of national state and supranational institutions. This is basically what EU is facing with, you know, throughout its history, and through the Lisbon Treaty, I guess at this point of time, these issues are addressed in the best possible way. So we feel quite comfortable as a small nation in this large community that the proper balance is established and our identity is preserved. So when it comes to Slovenia in EU, for us basically two issues are important: relationship between small or big countries. This relationship within the EU has considerably changed. In 1958, at the very beginning of the EU, this relationship was 3-3. Three small states, three big states. I will not name who are the big states, you know that. But by the latest EU enlargement, since 2007, this ratio is 6 big states and 21 small states. So you see, this is something that is for EU as in particular quite a challenge. You know, how then to meet expectations of small states within such a community. And second issue that we care much while being in EU is how EU can preserve our cultural diversity, multiculturalism as an EU value. That especially means Slovenian language, Slovenian cultural heritage. For a country again of 2 million, throughout these turbulent centuries of history, to preserve our language and culture, I could say it's quite an achievement, not only of Slovenia, but of this civilization. You know, the nations come and disappear with their languages. So we have opted really for EU because we firmly believe that EU is the framework within which we can pursue this basic interest of ours. And then how European Union is dealing with this diversity management. EU has developed instruments for diversity management two ways. One way that its member states brought it in. Take for example Belgium as a multinational state, they have difficulties. Their government resigned a few days ago. But they have instruments how to peacefully to manage these differences. And with this EU enlargement, also Slovenia, other countries brought their own experience from the past so that they enrich this EU toolbox how to deal with diversity. But at the same time, EU itself has designed its own instrument, especially through the principle of subsidiarity and solidarity. So this is something that EU is doing quite well. But that was enough for EU of 15 before the last EU enlargement in 2004 and 2007. The question is, what about now, are these instruments sufficient with EU 27, where diversity has considerably increased by including 10 plus two new countries, bringing in differences in culture, historical experience, economy. But still, this enlargement, which is important now for this debate, this enlargement, bringing this scope of diversity, this did not bring in differences in religion yet. But when we talk about further EU enlargement, we'll have to deal with that, because as Slovenia, we are a strong promoter of EU enlargement towards the Western Balkans. That would include Bosnia and Herzegovina, Kosovo. We are also strong supporter of EU enlargement with Turkey. So, you know, with this scope having in mind, then of course the differences in religion will also come in. And the question is EU ready to deal with that? Has EU instruments how to deal with this kind of diversity? The answer is not easy.
No, it's not. No. Certainly.
But you know, history lessons are telling us that that any integration is doomed to fail if based on discrimination and subordination. So, you know, before we decide this, in parallel, we have to develop instruments how to deal with these differences that we intend to bring in. Now, maybe a few words on interfaith and intercultural dialogue. Due to our historical experience, we in Slovenia, we do see intercultural, interfaith dialogue as a process that is critically important for creation of an open cultural environment in which people of different culture and religion live side by side in tolerance and mutual respect. And it is a job for governments to provide such, you know, a setting, such a toolbox, and to provoke, to promote such a dialogue on a national, regional, and global level. And when we were having 2 years ago EU presidency, intercultural dialogue was one of our priorities. In fact, we have established within one of our institutions, Center for European Perspective, we have established special task force on intercultural dialogue for Western Balkans. Globally, we are very much engaged, especially in through UN and Council of Europe. We are partners from the very beginning in tripartite forum on interfaith cooperation for peace, in Alliance of Civilization and ASEM Interfaith Dialogue. Mainly, this is under the auspices of UN. And when I was ambassador to UN, we focused on that very much, and that was the global exposure. And one should never estimate the need to be exposed and to be engaged in a global level. However, we believe that regional cooperation, regional engagement is of critical importance because this is the area where Slovenia as a small country in particular can provide added value, and this is where we engage most because this is where we can really show and demonstrate some results. And there are two basic reasons why, when it comes to interfaith and intercultural dialogue, we are engaged in the Western Balkans in particular. First, because we are still dealing with the consequences of violent conflict in former Yugoslavia. And secondly, because through intercultural dialogue, we can strengthen the EU perspective of these countries for the region. That is very important prerequisite, which basically means that we have to bring this, to make this culture more European, to fit more to this European family of nations. We know through the history and latest in particular that Western Balkans can serve us as an example for both constructive and destructive practices of intercultural dialogue, what is dialogue were in place. Especially when it comes to Bosnia and Kosovo, conflict in former Yugoslavia got also a religious dimension because mosques, Orthodox and Catholic churches were burned down. But I would like to make here a distinction because the conflict in Yugoslavia as such, especially when it started, was never about religion. It was about politics, it was about ethnicity in particular. And as a way of reconciliation, interfaith and intercultural dialogue is so important now. In Bosnia and Herzegovina in particular, and in Kosovo. In Bosnia and Herzegovina among three ethnic communities, and in Kosovo among Serbs and Kosovo Albanians. Kosovo Albanians are now being a majority nation after acquiring their own state. So before they were a minority, now they are as a majority. As a majority always has a more responsibility to take care about the minority. So now Kosovo Albanians have to pursue politics that will ensure protection of Serb minority. Mm-hmm. And maybe just as a way of conclusion, what specifically we do in the Western Balkans as our contribution. First, I mentioned already that Center for European Perspective, which is which is promoting interfaith, intercultural dialogue in the region. Secondly, we have initiated, especially within the Council of Europe, an inter-regional mobility project for Western Balkans, by which by 2012 we should abolish school fees for students for the region. For that purpose, Slovenia will also increase number of scholarship for Western Balkans. And thirdly, which has a broader dimension, as an instrument of enhancing regional cooperation, we have assisted and established Euro-Mediterranean University, so-called EMUNI, which was inaugurated in June 2008 during our EU presidency as our direct contribution to what I have defined as a priority during our EU presidency. So EMUNI is now acting as a coordinator and facilitator of joint academic and research activities together with partner institutions. EMUNI is a network of over 100 member institutions from 32 states. So this is really Euro-Mediterranean scope. And it brings together representatives of different culture, national, ethnic, and religious background. We believe in Slovenia, when you go, you know, from holistic debate, that education is really critical in fostering the respect and understanding among cultures. So that's the area where we believe the investment is worthwhile, and where we should engage, you know, and encourage our schools to open up to local, regional, national, and international environment, and to design curricula, to exchange, you know, students and professors, to train, you know, both categories, students and professors, and thus create, you know, a most favorable environment within which tolerance and dialogue can be promoted. Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you. You know, we'll open up for questions, but I think I'll go first. It's okay with everyone. I've made notes, several. And in the beginning, you spoke about how Slovenia, the people of Slovenia, have maintained their culture. And can you share a little bit about, you know, so the history and how that has affected how Slovenians have defined and currently define themselves and their culture, and how they've been able to maintain their rich culture in the midst of all of that.
Well, as a small nation, you have to be able to adapt. Mm.
Yes.
Not to be subjected, but to adapt to the environment, but at the same time stand strongly for what, you know, defines your identity. Mm-hmm. And, you know, 500 years ago we got the first book in Slovenian, and we are the only country in Europe that erected a monument to Napoleon. Mm-hmm. You would be amazed, because we don't like warriors. But Napoleon brought to Slovenia through Illyric provinces a prosperity which ensured, you know, strengthening of Slovenian culture and education. So now in the midst of Ljubljana, capital of Slovenia, we have a monument to Napoleon, which comes to great surprise, not only to French, but to many others. But at the same time, at our main square in Ljubljana, we have a monument to our greatest poet. Mm. So you will in vain search for monuments of warriors. So the poet is the reference to our national identity. And nurturing language is something that is deep in our mind and in our blood. And even when we gained our independence, now as a small country, we give quite a significant number of resources in terms of GDP for culture, mm-hmm. because that is something that at the end of the day defines a nation. So this history was turbulent,
yes.
and we were so often exposed to challenges,
right.
but in the decisive moments, you know, each nation has decisive moments where you have to stand up, where poets are not helpful anymore, when you have to take arms. And when that was needed, we have done that.
Yeah.
We were challenged in particularly, of course, in the Second World War mm-hmm. through Nazism and fascism. And
right.
at that time, our nation stood up, took
right.
arms. And secondly, in 1991, when Yugoslav army, you know, somehow mm-hmm. abandoned this spirit of community and you know was mm-hmm. simply ready to wipe us out,
right.
We had to stand up.
Right.
So, you know, you have to know when you have to stand up for yourself.
Right.
But of course, the more important is that you look for solutions, for instruments that, you know, are enabling the growth of your nation mm-hmm. in a larger community. Mm-hmm. That's why we feel now so safe within the European Union.
So going off of that, the importance of intercultural interfaith dialogue and with globalization, and you're speaking about how Slovenians can maintain also their rich culture and still engage, you know, whether it's globally or regionally, in dialogue. I think, you know, there's been talk about how we can balance the two, because we can get so immersed in the diversity and go forth and have the dialogue, which is very important, but also it's very important to be able to maintain, you know, who we are as a people, culturally, nationally, racially, you know, so on and so forth. So being able to balance these two, I think it's very important. And so can you speak about that and the balance of the dialogue and being able to maintain who you are as a people, and how important that is?
Well, that's why I said at the beginning that this diversity is a source of richness
mm-hmm.
And opportunities, but also a challenge.
Right.
Because if you nurture this diversity as a, you know, as a value,
mm-hmm.
then it means that not only you accept it, but you also promote it through building up institutions
mm-hmm.
that, you know, serves you well to address these differences.
Right.
And differences are there. They are not dealt with once forever. Even in United States, which is case in specific, you know, how you dealt with diversity. But even United States now, you may have problems. Now you look in Arizona, what the law has been passed. So
mm-hmm.
it means that diversity is never, you know, done.
Right.
You always have to deal with that. You
right.
always have to face with that.
Right.
It reappears in different forms. These differences reappear.
Mm-hmm.
Important is that they do not appear in a violent form, in a antagonizing. That's why tolerance, you know,
mm-hmm.
it should serve us as a value, as a
right.
point of departure, how to deal with that. And when you have these values present, when you have instruments,
yeah.
then you may fear not of any dialogue with different
right.
people of different mind, of different culture, beliefs.
Mm-hmm.
You feel safe in entering into that. So dialogue
right.
is not threatening you in
absolutely.
This aspect.
Absolutely. So we'll open it up to questions in the audience now. Yes, sir.
My name is Michael Frazier. I'm a professor at Howard University in the city here, and I traveled for the United States State Department speaking on diversity, and I've been to Ljubljana. And last year I was on a lecture tour in Belgrade as well as Novi Sad in Serbia. And during my talks and with the people I met with, the issue of diversity and management of diversity surfaced multiple times. And you're right, diversity is good, but it's also quite a challenge because it means that people have to do things different. And to develop tolerance, most people usually agree that the educational system is the key ingredient. So we've embarked upon University of Novi Sad and the University of Belgrade and Howard University with a research project. And I'm just curious, when you talk about diversity, have any of the universities been involved with any research efforts to develop a database, particularly as it relates to differences? Slovenia is different in the sense of the homogeneity that you spoke of, whereas other parts of the Balkans is quite diverse, with some peoples, particularly the Roma people, having difficulties with different national origins. So I'm just curious, have your universities been involved with developing cultural diversity or multicultural educational programs? Because they had not at all in Belgrade. They have talked about it and we're working on something, but it's not something that's been institutionalized. Mm-hmm. So if you can comment, please.
Well, to my knowledge, yes, we have a record of institutions specifically designed to address the issue of ethnicity, of ethnic communities, of religious communities. So for one specific reason, because you know, Slovenia as a small country, by default it happened that many Slovenes are living abroad. But we have never understood that, you know, as an issue that could expand our political agenda. What we cared about is to create conducive environment where these minorities, or these Slovenes living in other countries, you know, could feel this cultural space as a united one within which they can feel no differences in terms of travel, in terms of communication with Slovenia proper. But at the same time, we have two minorities, constitutional minorities in Slovenia, Hungarian and Italian. And this is also quite a unique solution in EU and in Europe, that they have ensured, constitutionally ensured, representation in the parliament. So each of them, they have one seat in the parliament. They have their own elections, but their seat is ensured. So in 90 members of the parliament, two of them belong by constitution to this minority. So we are very sensitive to minority issues. That would come, that's why we have quite a lot of centers for ethnic studies, you know. And again, these centers were designed, some of them even in former Yugoslavia, because Yugoslavia was a diversity, you know, a case of ethnic diversity. And we have promoted this dialogue very much, but not enough, again, because the environment was not conducive and supportive enough. Because it was not so much a question how, you know, to deal effectively with these differences, but just how to control these diversities. So we recognize now that now this is maybe opportunity again to reestablish certain links in the region through cooperation of universities, of institutes, how to bring these cultures back again and to increase the level of their communication and thus to ease these inter-ethnic tensions that exist in the region.
Thank you.
I, you know, you spoke about education and dialogue and how important, you know, these two are. I know that there are in Bosnia-Herzegovina, there are Turks that have founded schools based on this model of dialogue education. And so it seems, you know, that this seems to be the way, you know, to bring people together, that at the root cause of all, you know, racism, anti-religiosity, or anti-the other is coming and stemming from lack of education, and not just simply education about somebody else's culture, education in all realms, so from science to history to, yes, culture, religious. Can you speak more about that connection and how important that is, and how important civil society is in terms of making that happen in your country?
You mean in Slovenia?
Mm-hmm.
In Slovenia,
mm-hmm. Exactly.
In Slovenia proper, yeah. Well, you know, this, the latest experience that we had in former Yugoslavia for us was a very rich opportunity, so to say. And one could speculate that really, if we had some instrument in hand, if we had a minimum of tolerance and respect, that, you know, such community could be preserved even.
Right.
But every multinational community, you know, is tested with this challenge. Mm. And it's not accident that when these multinational communities are attached to certain ideology, they did not survive the test of history. Look that for Soviet Union, mm-hmm. Czechoslovakia, mm-hmm. Yugoslavia, you know, Spain is also, you know, very diverse, mm-hmm. Belgium, but they have developed timely enough democratic instruments to ensure that. So Slovenia has been enriched by this experience in the past. That's why we are aware of the importance, you know, of these instruments that we have to have to promote tolerance, dialogue. And we are also aware that this is something that the government has to be on guard all the time, mm. to look mm-hmm. after it. Mm-hmm. It's good that you have civil society.
Sure.
And of course, the civil society also in Slovenia is very rich in, you know, promoting this dialogue. But as they say, democracy, you know, it's a tough call.
Yeah.
In democracy, you have, you know, you have ideas that surface up that you may disagree very much. Mm-hmm. Just this morning again, I was listening to one minister saying that, you know, this extreme right is on rise in Central Eastern Europe, and that's also sometimes a challenge of democracy, mm-hmm. where, you know, extreme ideas are coming up and are facing, you know, other part of society in an aggressive way.
Right.
Because democracy, by definition, should avoid aggressiveness in dealing with any issue. So these groups that have more radical, aggressive ideas, they may find this environment quite conducive to pursue their own ideas. So that's always a challenge to democracy. Fortunately enough, in Slovenia we don't have such a one. Although we have a small parliamentarian party, which is a right-wing one, and that exploits here and there issues, you know, of equality, also issues of Roma. We have a small population, Roma population, but, you know, again, that serves us as a test of our tolerance always,
right.
and every day.
Sure.
And to my mind, we are doing well in ensuring this quality for a Roma population as well. But again, you are never, you know, secured from some deviations here.
No. It's always there, yeah. I think. Yeah. I think, you know, the greater EU, the region that that you're in, and it's a challenge right now. Do you have hope that there will be, you know, there is a lot of voices speaking, right wing, far, mainly anti-diversity, you know, saying there is one Europe and this is how it looks. But as you've said, their diversity is there already, and it's potentially growing. It will grow. It will expand. Do you have hope that Europe will come out of, you know, this with in a positive way? You know, being growing with this diversity in a positive manner, acceptance, tolerance, respect. Do you have hope for this for the greater region?
Yes, I have hope, especially because one should look back, you know, it has been 60 years and so
right.
since Europe was a complete failure, a complete disaster. One could not imagine after the Second World War that this, you know, that this continent, that this region, these countries could be rebuilt, that
right.
that some, you know, dialogue could be established, some mm-hmm. cooperation among these warring parties. So the way that we have made in the past 65 years is a good source of hope where
Absolutely.
Europe can go in the future. So mm-hmm. we need a certain degree of patience in doing so. We have to always encourage positive processes. But I would never give up, you know, to raise hopes for Europe, a future which right. would really embrace everybody who is in Europe.
Yes.
In terms, not only in terms of geography, but in terms also of beliefs and religion.
Right. Good to hear. I think we have one more question.
Ambassador Kirn, thank you very much for your enlightening speech. It is an interesting concept to having fostering the national identity and trying to be part of a more wider community or supranational community. And as we know, the attempt to establish a new constitution in the Europe wasn't so successful. And I wonder to what extent the national identity was perceived under the threat in that response, or to what extent it affected such a response, and is it feasible in the near future to have such a constitution?
Well, we have Lisbon Treaty now, and that, for the time being, that's it. We have to be realistic when we design our future steps, but we should not overdo it, as I say. We should now wait and see and work for that, how to implement Lisbon Treaty. Lisbon Treaty is, at this point of time, the possible compromise and consent among all 27 countries. And it entails a lot of ingredients to reinforce European Union globally, but at the same time to maintain the sovereignty of nation states within the European Union. So now when Lisbon Treaty is still a hot piece of paper on the table, I would not dwell on federative, you know, Europe and this and that. This remains, you know, for generations to come. I don't know, maybe it will be in 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, I don't know. But one should look the EU integration as a process. And when you see that span of the process that has been, you know, passed already, then you can be confident that this process will continue also in the future. But we should not overdo it. We have to strengthen each moment that reflects the common will and consent of all its member states. Because that means that this building has a solid foundations, that it will not be shaken, that it takes into account interests and concerns of its member states.
Please join me in thanking Ambassador Roman Kirn for today's talk. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us. It's been an honor to speak with you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.